Let us pray. Father, we are so blessed. Thank you, Father, first of all, for yourself and your Son. But Father, we are immensely pleased that you have allowed us the privilege of living here in America. We thank you for our flag, for the red, white, and blue. For our men and women, Father, who have fought in the past, who are serving today. Many, Father, in harm's way. Many have given their lives, Father, in defense of our country. And we thank you, Father, for the privilege of living where people are still free to worship, free to meet as we are this morning. Free, Father, to praise you and to lift our voices, to sing together, and to hear your word proclaimed. Father, it's all because we live in this great country, and we thank you for our flag. We thank you for the privilege, Father, of being here today. We ask a very special blessing upon this service, upon your servant who will come and share your word with us. For those, Father, that will play the musical instruments and those that will sing for us today, Father. May it all, Father, just bring honor and glory to your great name. In your Son's name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
Well, let's remain standing. Thank you, Joe. Thank you, Roger. And let's praise the Lord. Last week we had our biggest crowd we've had since we've been meeting together. Had 371 people last week into both services. And it was an incredible day. But guess what? Today's a new day. We need a fresh anointing for today. We can't bank on last week's time, okay? So we all got to be fresh and ready to worship the Lord this morning. So say amen.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, just being restored.
And though there are
days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword. Still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way. Behold he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the ear of Jubilee, out of Zion's hill salvation come. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are white in the world. And we are your laborers in your vineyard, declaring, Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. And out of Zion to salvation.
Behold, he comes,
riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. And the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion to salvation comes.
There's no God like Jehovah. Here we go.
There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. Lift your voice. It's the year
I'm glad he's coming again. I'm glad I can claim that promise.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name.
Blessed be
when
your
I'm
name.
When I'm found in the desert place.
In the desert
though I walk through the wilderness.
Though I walk through the wilderness.
Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name.
When the sun's shining down on me.
Shining down on me.
The world's all as it should be.
The world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name. Margaret's offering.
Though there's pain in the offering.
In the offering.
Yes, blessed be your name.
Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say,
oh,
blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory.
Watching TV the last few weeks. We've all been in our houses for about 3 months. And the thing that's amazing to me is everybody's been cooped up. And then what we see on our TVs right now, I never thought I'd see that kind of thing. And I'll tell you what, it just shows me that there's a world looking for answers somewhere. And if the church will be the church, they'll find the right answer. We've been given a great opportunity as a church, as the children of God, to shine and be the salt and light in this world that it's needed for so long. But if we're not going to do that, we're condemning people. It's our responsibility. If you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, it's our responsibility to live and point and talk, to point people to the answer. That's we always think about, well, I'm going to heaven, I'm doing this and that, but we have a responsibility. As a child of God, we've got a responsibility. Now, I say a responsibility like it sounds. I think it's a privilege to say, praise the Lord. I think it's a privilege to say, I know the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And He knows me, Tom. That's the cool part of this thing. Someone's saying, I'll worship only. The key word in this song right here is only at the feet of Jesus. ABC.
Thank you all so much for being here this morning. We're not done with worship. We're continuing just after this. But worship, as we said last week, is not just about singing, but it's about every part of what you do. And my question for you is this, and please don't answer this out loud. Did you come to church full this morning? You see, if you can answer the question yes, then I'm afraid you lived your week wrong. See, the Sabbath used to be at the end of the week. They would spend their whole week following God, emptying themselves, serving the Lord faithfully, and then they would come to His house to be filled again, to go and do the same thing. And see, we've gotten it backwards. We believe we're supposed to come to church full of the blessings we've been given the week before. But church is so we can be filled again. You say, Josh, where did that blessing go? Where did all those blessings go that we're not supposed to bring with us? We're supposed to give those out to others. In Hebrews 10:25, it talks about not forsaking the assembling ourselves. But see, it doesn't stop there. There's not a period at the end of that. It's just a comma. Because the rest of that passage says, and stirring one another up to good works, all the more as you see the day approaching. The reason we come here is to encourage each other, to love on each other, to pray with each other, to worship together, to fill each other up on the blessings of what God gives us on this day, and then spend the rest of the week giving that out to those that need it. We see a hurting world right now that needs the blessing of God. And as God's people, we can give them that blessing. If we would be willing to come to church empty and not full. And so as we pray together, and they're going to continue leading us in worship, I hope that your mindset, your call to worship, not just today, but for the rest of the week. Am I coming back next Sunday empty or full? And how can I change my life to where I do come back empty every Sunday, ready to receive a new oil, a fresh wine from Jesus Christ? Lord, as we continue worshiping God, this challenge is not just for the people sitting in front of me, God, but for me as well. Too many times, God, I come to church full, and I can't receive anything new because I haven't given anything that you've given me. God, I pray you push me, Lord, to be empty next Sunday when I come back. I pray you push us all to be empty. Lord, I pray you encourage us to worship you fully today through spirit and truth, in worship, in the word, in meditating, in prayer, and whatever it takes, God. And then, Lord, I pray you push us to sacrifice and to give Lord, and to show people who you are, to show your son, Jesus Christ. Not to get in arguments on Facebook, not to worry about making sure people hear our opinion over anyone else's, but that when they look at us, they see the cross of Jesus Christ. We thank you, God, for this call to worship. We thank you, Lord, for those that are leading us this morning. And Holy Spirit, I just pray you inhabit this place, inhabit our praise, inhabit these men and women of God as they lead us this morning, so that we only see you, Jesus. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I'm going to do something a little bit different right now. Brother Allen, we want to anoint you this morning. And I want to ask our men to come forward. Brother Allen's going to have a procedure done this week, and he had asked me about a week or so ago. Brother Allen Lowe was going to be having that done. So if we could get our men to come up, he wanted to be anointed, so we'll anoint him. And also, while we pray for Alan, we also want to lift up, we had a loss in our family. Brother J.C. Bell used to come up and pray with us here around people and used to pray for many of you through times. Brother J.C. had his redemption made complete yesterday. He went to be with the Lord. So we want to pray for Ruby and the boys, Aaron and Eric, and just lift them up today. So, Brother Gary, I'm going to ask you to lead us.
Dear Heavenly Father, we're just so privileged, Father, this morning to come into your house, to gather together in your name, Father Lord. And Father God, I just love you this morning. I thank you, Father God, for every one of these men that's gathered this morning. And Father, I pray for the anointing of God to come down, Lord, that we may be a hold your presence, Father God, and we can leave. Father God, that we've never seen it on this such. And Father God, I pray that you'll touch him, Lord, right now in the name of Jesus. Father God, that we gather together. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray, Father God, you'll touch him, Lord. You'll heal him, Father Lord. God, we just pray this, God, that your will be done, Father Lord. And I pray, Father God, every time we gather, Lord, you'll gather in our midst, Father God. Lord, you'll be high and lifted up, Father God, because we come in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ this morning, Father. How grateful we are, Lord. How blessed we are this morning, Father God. Feel your presence, Father Lord. Oh, God, I love you this morning. I thank you, Father. Thank you for your hope, Lord, that you give us, the peace that you give us, Father. Lord, how grateful we are this morning. And, Father, we lift up our cares, our burdens to you, Father God, this morning. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, amen and amen.
Well, let's continue worshiping. Wayne, let's start with that chorus there. Everybody knows this chorus. Stand with me now.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh.
First, Brian.
Nations singing louder. Cause nothing has the power to save but your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name lays a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder. Cause nothing has the power to save
but your name.
But your name. But your name. But your name. I love you, Lord. And I lift my
Amen. Where's Damon at? Damon, come up here. Y'all may be seated.
Lily of the valley, let your sweet aroma fill my life. Rose of Sharon, show me how to grow in beauty in God's sight. Fairest of 10,000, make me a reflection of your life. Day star, shine down on me. Let your love shine through me in the night. Lead me, Lord, I'll follow. Shine down on me. Let your love shine through me in the night. Lord, I see a world that's dying, wounded by the master of deceit. Oh, they're groping in the dark. They're haunted by the years of past defeat. But I see you standing near me, Lord, shining with compassion in your eyes. I pray, Jesus, shine down on me. Let your love shine through me in the night. Oh, lead me, Lord, I'll follow. Anywhere you open up the door.
stars shine down on me. Let your love shine through me in the night. Day stars shine down on me. Let your love shine through me in the night.
I don't know what you need this morning, but I'm going to tell you what. He's the day star. He's the lily of the valley. He's the bright and morning star. He's my healer. He's my peace speaker. He's everything that I need and more. Whatever you need today, Jesus is. Whatever it is. Damon, sing that second verse again.
Lord, I see a world that's dying. They're haunted by the years of past defeat. They're all groping in the darkness, haunted by the years of past defeat. But I see you standing near me, Lord, shining with compassion in your eyes. I pray, Jesus, shine down on me. Let your love shine through me in the night. Lead me, Lord, I'll follow.
Well, amen. I'm excited today about our preacher. Some of you will know him. Maybe his name will be familiar to you. Brother Jody, I've had several people even tell me back before this virus thing kicked in, said, you need to call Brother Jody. He's a preaching machine. I said, well, I'll try to call him. Then the virus thing came in. I didn't know what to do. And then we called the other day, and I will tell you, he's been one of the most gracious men just to talk with. And I've listened to, got to hear him, but I've never got to hear Brother Jody live. And also, before I say anything else, Jody, I want to welcome our good friends, Kim and Damon back there. Dear friends of our church and many of us, we're glad you all are here. But Brother Damon, Brother Jody, I pray that as you come up here, that the Lord would hide you behind the cross. That he'd empty you out. Because we really need to hear from God today. We need a word from him. We don't need a word from anybody else. And brother, we love you. Would y'all put your hands together and bring Brother Jody up to the podium?
Well, I like to be around a place where you feel the presence of the Lord. And I felt God here today. I need that. God's been good to me. Been good to you too. I'm preaching out of the overflow today. Everything that the Lord's brought us through this last year, wow, it's only by the grace of God I'm standing before you. And what a privilege to be here. And that singing is outstanding. And I'm thanking the Lord for that. That's somebody using the gift that God's given them, you see. I'll be honest with you, I want to be a help to you. I want you to leave today understanding what's been said. And I want you to leave today understanding the message that God is giving to you. As you take your Bible, I want you to turn to the book of Habakkuk. Yes, that is a Bible book. Did you know that? The book of Habakkuk, it's in the Old Testament, close to the end of it. The book of Habakkuk, chapter 3. Today I'm preaching to you a sermon I've just recently put together. And it's just a miracle to see where the Lord had me when I started going through a major, deep, dark depression over a year ago now. I was studying in our church this book, but I had not come to this chapter. And when you come to this chapter, it's a great little book. It's just three chapters long, but this third chapter is the chapter that God's laid on my heart for this hour. And I want to say something to you. Anytime the Word of God is opened and the Word of God is preached for what God said, God is speaking to us. Amen. What is it He's trying to tell us today? And this passage of Scripture is very applicable, not just for the day in which we live, but for the rest of our life. I'll be honest with you, this little book has been a help to me. And may God use it to be a help to you today. In Habakkuk chapter 3, I'm just going to read one verse of Scripture to get our title. I'm preaching on this entire chapter. But we get our title in verse number 16. In Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 16, Habakkuk says, "When I heard, my belly trembled. My lips quivered at the voice. Rottenness entered into my bones. And I trembled in myself, that I might rest in the day of trouble. When he cometh up unto the people, he will invade them with his troops." You say, what's going on? I'll explain it, but I want you to notice the phrase close to the end, kind of in the middle there of the verse, where he said that I might find rest in the day of trouble. And today I'm preaching to you on this subject, rest in the day of trouble. Let's pray together. Father, would you help me? And would you honor the prayers of your precious children today, who have prayed that they don't hear from man, but God, that we all hear from you. Would you hide me behind the sacred desk, behind the cross of Calvary? And as these precious people look this way, may they not hear me, may they not even see me, but may they hear the voice of God. Deal with us thoroughly. Use this chapter. I have no doubt this is what you want me to preach, but Lord, I confess, I cannot preach without your help. Help me today, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. What a book, what a story, what a prophet, what a God. Habakkuk has been on a journey when you come to chapter 3 of life that is so helpful and applicable to us today. When you study this particular book of the Bible, you'll notice in chapter 1 how he was so burdened that he began to question God. But he knew in chapter 1, even though he was questioning God and God was a little confusing to him, he knew he could trust the character of God. That's chapter 1. In chapter 2, you'll see how he was determined to watch for God to speak to him. And God did speak to him. And then the Lord told him in the remaining part of chapter 2 that he was going to judge Babylon as well as Judah, if you will. And the just, chapter 2, verse 4, is just to live by faith. Then we come to chapter 3, which is where we're at in this particular sermon today. And Habakkuk begins to pray. And when we come to that verse that gives us our text in verse number 16, we read something about Habakkuk that described himself in this time of learning all that God was doing. And by the way, he didn't fully understand it all either. But when he was learning and traveling through this book about the character of God, he said in verse number 16, he said his belly trembled, his lips quivered, rottenness was in his bones, and he was trembling within himself. This lets us know that he was severely affected. He even called it trouble. And this word trouble means anguish, affliction, or distress. This lets us know that he was in tremendous sorrow. He was in tremendous suffering and tremendous grief. I wonder, have you ever been there? Are you there now? If so, before we get to the main thought of the message, let us pause here for a moment and show just that because you're going through something that affects you like this, it doesn't mean that you're showing lack of faith. As a matter of fact, in chapters 1 and chapter 2, we have already seen how this is a man of great faith in the midst of trouble. And yet here he is in tremendous grief and sorrow of mind. He was to the point that it was hard for him to speak or to stand. He says that in this chapter. He said, I can't hardly speak. I can't even hardly stand on my feet. Yet he declares that he might have rest in the day of trouble. This means he can be comforted, to be settled down. In other words, he's saying, even though the things around me are troubling me, I have found a resting place. In other words, Habakkuk tells us that it is possible to be at rest even when you're troubled. Even when you're sorrowful, you're suffering, and you're grieving. He said, in the midst of all this trouble with my nation about to be destroyed, he said, I've found a place of rest. It's this thought that the Lord drew my attention to in this chapter. The thought that there is rest in the day of trouble. Where is this rest found? And I submit to you that this is what we're going to look at. This rest is found in what Habakkuk did in this chapter. And you know as well as I do that life is full of trouble sometimes. We live in a day right now in our country that we need to get on our face and beg God for mercy. In wrath, remember mercy. Asking God to help our country. We're living in trouble sometimes. I've gone through a lot of trouble in the last year where God has delivered me from deep, dark, paralyzing depression. The time where I resigned the church where I was pastoring. And the time whenever I thought my life was over. Yes, I'm telling you, I'm just being transparent with you during that deep, dark time. And I'm not preaching on that, but I'm just emphasizing to you that we all have our troublesome times. And during that time, a preacher of the gospel was so depressed that I had suicidal thoughts. I never acted on it, but I contemplated it. I'm just trying to tell you that life is full of trouble sometimes. There are times when things come that can just sap the strength out of you, and if you're not careful, you can go so far down that you forget the resting place. And I'm telling you this morning that as we study this chapter together, I see four major things that Habakkuk did during this time of trouble. In other words, these four things that he did helped him find rest even when life scared the daylights out of him. Now let's note how all four of these things revolve around what he did with his Lord. It's not what he did with the circumstance. It's not what he did with his trouble. No, it's what he did with his God. And I want us to look at what Habakkuk did in his time of trouble that helped him find rest. And I'm telling you that if you'll put these four things down in your heart and in your mind when the trouble comes, these four things can help you to find rest. In a crowd this size, great crowd for just one service. In a crowd this size, no doubt many of you are troubled. And maybe troubled about things that nobody on planet Earth know. Maybe only you know about it. Or maybe you and your wife, or you and your husband, or maybe you and somebody else, or maybe you just feel all isolated that nobody knows and nobody cares, and you're troubled inside. I want to tell you something. Life is full of trouble, but there is a resting place. There is a place you can find comfort. There's a place you can find peace. And there's a place that even though the world is spinning out of control, and maybe your world is spinning out of control, you can put your head on your pillow at night knowing that the best day is yet to come. I want to help you. I'm preaching part of my story to you today. I've lived through chapter 1. It took me about a year to figure it out. That when you can't understand and you don't know and you can't figure life out, all you can do is say, I don't understand, God, but I know that you are God. You're eternal. And I know I can trust the character of God. That's chapter 1. Chapter 2, you learn that lesson in chapter 1. Chapter 2, you just begin to trust that he's going to answer your prayers. And you wait on him. It's hard to wait, isn't it? When you come to chapter 3, this mighty prophet of God, I'll be honest with you, I want to meet Habakkuk. By the time you leave today, I hope you know more about Habakkuk than you ever have. He's one of the unsung heroes in the Bible. What a prophet. And when we look at these four things that he did to find rest in trouble, these are four things that he wants to do in your life. Number one, here we go now. The first thing he did to find rest in the day of trouble. Number one, it's so simple, but yet it's so profound. So profound. Number one, he prayed to his Lord. Look at verse number one, a prayer of Habakkuk, the prophet upon Shigionoth. O Lord, I've heard thy speech and was afraid. O Lord, revive thy work in the midst of the years. In the midst of the years, make known in wrath. Remember mercy. While this chapter is basically just the details of Habakkuk's prayer. In other words, this whole chapter is his prayer. Let's not miss the point that Habakkuk prayed. That's what I'm saying. He took his burden to the Lord. He cast his burden upon his God. And there's no doubt that this is one of the ways to find rest in the day of trouble, is to go to God in prayer and cast your burden upon the Lord. As we consider this simple yet profound truth, I see four things about his prayer here, just in these two verses. That as we take our burden to the Lord, there's four things to help us understand how we're to do that. Number one, under this, he recognized and respected the Lord. You see this in the opening phrase here in verse number two. He said, O Lord, look at that. And notice it's all capital letters. It's capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. That is the designated name for Jehovah God. In other words, that's the self-existent, covenant-making, covenant-keeping God. And in all of this, Habakkuk was recognizing the fact that he was speaking to the God of eternity, who can be trusted to keep his promises even when life doesn't make sense. Life's not making sense to Habakkuk, but he's traveled through the first two chapters. And he comes and he begins to pray. And he says, oh Lord, I recognize who you are. You will keep your promises. He's respecting him. He's recognizing him. Second thing here is he got honest with God. We see this in verse number two. Notice he said, oh Lord, I have heard thy speech and was what? And was afraid. You know what this tells me? There's some debate here as to whether Habakkuk is speaking of his fear of God or if he's just speaking of an emotion that he was feeling because of all what God has told him here. But either way, don't miss this point here. The Lord spoke to me here and how he just got honest with God in his praying. He told the Lord exactly how he felt at this time. Are you listening to me? God knows how you feel anyway. So if you're angry, tell him. If you're upset, tell him. If you're afraid, tell him. It's not okay to stay those ways, but listen to me, folks. It's hard to stay that way when you get honest with God. Did you know that? It really is. I'm just saying the first thing he did is he prayed to his Lord. I'm trying to help you put something that will help you, not just today, but the rest of your life. How do you find rest in the day of trouble? Well, number one, you pray to your God. You pray to your Lord. And when you pray, we're looking at his prayer, you recognize who he is. He's God. You respect who he is. He's the Lord. You get honest with him. Third thing about his prayer here is he submitted to God's will and plan. We see this in verse number 2. Notice what he said. He said, "Oh Lord, revive thy work." You know how God spoke to me here? Notice now, God's just told him, your country is going into captivity to the Babylonians. This is the book of Habakkuk. He can't figure out life. He can't connect the dots here. And yet when he comes to the last chapter of it, he changes a little bit, if you will, and he says, "Oh God, you just revive your work. You do whatever you want to do." Notice he didn't say, "Oh God, deliver me. Oh God, change your mind." No. He's simply saying, "I want you to do your work." He doesn't pray that God would change his plan. He had come to the position in which, in effect, he said, "Whatever I and my countrymen may have to suffer is no concern so long as your work is revived." In other words, Habakkuk was submitting to God's plan. He was submitting to God's will. You know, sometimes when we pray, we go to God demanding things. We may not mean to. And we think to ourselves, "Well, if he answers my prayer, then I'll serve him. If not, he might not love me." And that's not true. The fact of the matter is biblical praying is in submission to the will of God. And sometimes what he allows in our life may not be what we ask for or what we want, but it is best for his work and his will and his way. He was submitting to God's will above his own. This is all under the prayer here. And the fourth thing we notice about his prayer is he just made his request known to God. We see this in verse number 2. He said, "In wrath, just remember mercy, God." He made his request known. This is the first point. The first way to find rest in trouble, in the day of trouble, is you must pray to your Lord. And one way to find rest in the day of trouble here is by praying, by recognizing who he is that you're talking to, by respecting him when you do come to him, by getting honest with him and just telling him how you feel, by submitting to his will and just plainly asking him for what your heart desires. In other words, one way to find rest in the day of trouble is to cast your burden upon the Lord and just leave it there. And there's a second thing we see he did. And I will not read these verses because it spans from verse 3 down through verse number 15. I would encourage you to read this later, but this is the second major thing that we see Habakkuk did to find rest in the day of trouble. He prayed to his Lord, but number 2, he pondered what his Lord had already done. We see this in verses 3 through 15. In these verses, Habakkuk was remembering what their God had already done for them. As one man said, Habakkuk remembers in these verses that his God is majestic, verses 3 through 5. His God is mighty, verses 6 through 12. And his God is merciful in verses 13 to 15. He remembers how God delivered them from Egyptian bondage. You'll read this in these verses. He rehearses how God led them through the wilderness, how he helped them as they crossed the Jordan River to defeat their enemies. He spoke of the time that the sun and moon stood still to prolong the day so the battle would be won in Joshua's day, along with other things. He's talking about what God has already done. The prophet, is in reminding himself of the facts and of the power of God, is also assuring himself in the present, in these events, that God was but keeping his word and fulfilling the oath given to Abraham and repeated to Isaac and Jacob. God had said they were his people, that he had a certain purpose for them, and so they seemed to be overwhelmed in Egypt. He brought them out and sustained them in all their troubles, and Habakkuk's just reminding himself, remember how bad it was in Egypt? I mean, just think about all the trouble sometimes there, and God came through then, and if God can do it then, God can still do it today. The point in all of this is Habakkuk rehearsed how good and faithful his God had already been to them in the past, and he would be faithful to them in the future. This is another way to find rest in the day of trouble. It's to remind yourself and meditate on how good and how faithful God has already been to you. During times of trouble, it's good to remember the things that God's already done for us. Isaiah 46 verse 9 says, "Remember the former things of old." And this is good advice, especially during times and days of trouble. Let me ask you a question. How good has God been to you? You say, what, has God been too good to me? Really? Really? I mean, you got clothes on. Your stomach is full. Maybe not the way you want it to be, but you understand what I'm saying to you. He puts food on our table. You are living in the United States of America. If you are saved, he's delivered you from a burning hell. God has been good. No doubt about this. God's been good to me. I know he has. I don't deserve to be here. I look at myself. I failed the Lord in my mind. When I went into that deep, dark depression, I failed the Lord. I was living by my feelings instead of by faith. But you know what? God's taught me some things. And one thing he's taught me is he really will never leave us and never forsake us. I mean, he's allowed me to preach here today. I can't hardly believe that. And I'm telling you, God's just been so good to us. I know the current times can be troublesome. I know when you turn the news on, it can cause you trouble. I know that some of you are going through things and you just can't connect the dots. You can't figure it out. It just doesn't make sense. I've been there. I've been there. And I'm just telling you that there's a way that you can rest in the day of trouble. One way is to pray to him. Another way is just to remember, to ponder what he's already done for you. He's faithful, friends. If he's done it in the past, he'll do it today. There's a third thing he did. These are some of the most familiar verses in this book and maybe even part of the Bible. The third thing he did was he pledged, he promised. He made a pledge to rejoice in his Lord. Look here, please, no matter what happens. Verse 17, look at it. Although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall fruit be in the vines. The labor of the olive shall fail, and the field shall yield no meat. The flock shall be cut off from the fold, and yet there shall be no herd in the stalls. Look here, please. He's saying if the bottom falls out, although I lose everything. Look at the next verse and that word, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. We note in these verses the resolve of Habakkuk. He says that although devastation may come, he is decided, he is resolved to rejoice in the Lord and the joy in the God of his salvation. I like to think about the opening words of these two verses and connect them to show a great principle. The first word of verse 17, the first word he said, although. And the first word of verse 18, he said, yet. Although, yet. This book began, if you study this book began with Habakkuk asking why. But it ends with him saying, yet. He's determined. He's determined that no matter how bad life gets, he's already chosen to rejoice in the Lord. It's as if Habakkuk said, I sure don't understand all that's happening, but I'm going to thank God anyhow. You know, this is faith. It's faith that worships God when life is dark. Philippians 4:4 says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. You know, I like it when the Lord shows up and we shout and we get excited. I love that. Sometimes in my own personal life, I like to raise my hand. I did that a lot over here. And praise God. But sometimes the Lord just comes near me and it's just like he settles me down. And says, I want to talk to you. Reminded of a story here. By the way, what are we looking at? We're looking at how to rest in the day of trouble. Hey, if you don't need this today, you will. You will. And there's rest. There's hope. There's peace. And one way to find it is you make the decision today. Whatever happens, if the bottom falls out, I'm already resolved. I'm going to praise God. Easy to say it, hard to do it, friends. There's a story. I heard this from a preacher. I actually read it from a book here. It's a great story. Illustrates what Habakkuk's saying here. There's a story heard long ago about a husband and his wife and their little boy. And the wife became very ill and died as a result of her illness. The day she was buried, the husband and the son went back to their house. The day wore on, the darkness came and bedtime approached. The little boy asked if he could sleep with his daddy. Remember, this was the day that his mother's body had been buried. The daddy granted him permission, and they went into the room to sleep together that night. And after they crawled into bed and turned out the lights, the little boy called out to his father, and he said, "Listen," he said, "Daddy, it's dark in here, and I'm lonely, and I miss Mama." He said, "You don't have to turn the lights on. If you just turn over in the bed with your face toward me, I'd feel so much better." The father said to his young son, "In the darkness of that room, I'll do that." He turned over in the bed, and though the child could not see him, he knew his daddy was looking at him. He was comforted and was able to sleep, knowing that his father's face was turned toward him. You know, there are many times when we do not understand all that's going on. The darkness does not lift. The pain persists. But as long as we know that our Heavenly Father is looking at us, that His eyes are upon us, that we're still in His care, we can make it through even the darkest of nights. We want His face turned toward us. This is what Habakkuk was saying. He's saying, "Yet I will rejoice in the Lord." Let us learn to live in the yet. Living in the yet is living in the presence of the Lord when the present surroundings are not what we wish them to be. In the darkness of this world, when it seems as if things are out of control, my heart has come to know that God's face is turned toward me. Everything was gone for Habakkuk, but God was not. And he found that when everything was gone, God was still there, and God is enough. Realize that all the dark clouds are never going to lift until the trumpet sounds. And I am looking forward to the trumpet sounding. But I'm telling you, the dark clouds, not all of them are going to lift until the trumpet sounds and the Son of God comes and we see His face. But until then, we can still rejoice in the person of Jesus Christ. This is the decision Habakkuk made, and it's one all of God's children can and should make. God help us to make the same pledge. By the way, you'll never make that pledge until you learn chapter 1 just to trust the character of God. You never make that pledge until you learn chapter 2, verse number 4, the just shall live by faith. It's not by feelings. Job made this same decision, you understand. When he had lost so much, he said in chapter 1, verse 21, "Naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither." He said, "The Lord gave, the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." In this we see where to praise God for who He is, not what He does or doesn't do. We're looking at rest in the day of trouble. How do you find it? Same way Habakkuk did. You pray to your God. And when you pray, I gave you some things to help your prayer life there. Hey, you not only pray to your God, but secondly, folks, you ponder what He's already done for you. You just remember how good He's been already. You pledge to rejoice in Him no matter what. You say, "God, although this happens, yet I'm going to rejoice in You. I'm going to trust You and believe You." And by the way, that doesn't mean that you're a giant of faith. It's just a mustard seed. And there's a fourth thing here. A fourth thing He did that helped Him rest in the day of trouble. And that is, He put His faith and hope in God. I see this in verse number 19, and I'll explain this. He said, "The Lord God is my strength. He will make my feet like hinds' feet, deer's feet. And He will make me to walk upon mine high places." Now, what in the world is He saying here? This is a wonderful way this book ends. Habakkuk's been on a journey of questions and concerns. The day in which he's living is not a wonderful time for his people. God has pronounced judgment upon them, chapter 1. Things are not going well. The news was not good news. This was a dark time in the life of Habakkuk and his nation. However, when all is said and done, he ends this book by declaring his faith and hope is not in favorable circumstances, but rather in his God. He said, "The Lord is my strength. He'll make my feet like hinds' feet. He'll make me to walk upon mine high places." In other words, Habakkuk saying, God's all I need. God is enough. His faith was not in his circumstances, but in his God. He also said that God would make his feet like a deer. If you know anything about a deer, they can leap over obstacles. And they can run sure-footedly through difficult times. He went on to say that God would make him walk upon his high places. In other words, he's saying, God's going to lift me on high to help me live above my difficulties. He speaks of grace and agility and swiftness. High places speak of the mountaintop where the deer is free from the danger below. Habakkuk is telling us that God enables him to rise above his circumstances, and God gives him the strength to stand above the battle and enjoy precious freedom in the Lord. In all of this, during this time of bad news that would affect his life tremendously. In chapter 16, just the way he described himself, I mean, he's affected tremendously. His emotions are everywhere. Have you ever been there? Scared to death, but knowing he can trust God, but yet it's just a battle between faith and fear going on. That's Habakkuk. But he realizes during this time of bad news that's affecting him tremendously, he can declare his faith and hope in God. And what a life. What a life lesson and challenge we all need to learn here. As one man said, Christians need not fear the loss of anything in his life when their hope is in the everlasting God. Isaiah 12 verse 2 says, "Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For the Lord Jehovah is my strength and song. He's become my salvation." You know what's interesting to note? What the name Habakkuk means. You know what it means? It means to embrace. It means to hug. And this book is about this man coming to the point that he just embraces God, no matter what. He had come to the point that even though he could not figure out all that was happening, he was just going to hold on to God. Amen. And not let go. Habakkuk stood on the eve of captivity and said, "I can't change the hordes of Babylonians that are coming down upon us." He said, "I can't change the wicked desire of Nebuchadnezzar to take the land of Judah. I can't change the fact that the temple will be destroyed and God's people carried away. But I know that my God is a God of majesty, a God of might, and a God of mercy." Chapter 3, I'm just going to trust him and rest in him. May we learn this lesson and apply it to our lives. Let's determine to trust him no matter what happens in life. Let us understand that it's in the valley that we learn more about our God than on the mountaintop. It really is. It's in the dark days that we learn more about who God is than on the bright days. I am living, breathing proof of that. This book opened with a question mark. Why, God? But it ends with an exclamation point. I'm going to trust you, Lord. As we come to the close of this glorious book, let's not only agree that we will learn this, but let's be enthusiastic about it. You say, where's that coming from, verse 1? There's a word there that you probably don't recognize. It says, upon Shigonoth. You know what that means? It's a musical term. And it means to sing with strong emotion. It means to sing this with high-spirited praise, vigorous enthusiasm. It's praise punctuated with exclamation marks. And when we by faith lift our voices in the dark times with enthusiasm, I'm not talking about you're on the mountaintop. I'm talking about when the day is so dark you can't see your hand in front of your face. I'm talking about the day that you're in the deepest valley that you've ever been in, when you, by faith, enthusiastically, that doesn't mean you're shouting, this is great, no, but your faith, and through the darkness, Just like that little boy with his daddy says, I'm afraid. I miss my mama. This hurts, God. I don't understand what's happening, God. But by faith, I know you're good. And I know you can be trusted. And I know that you're perfect and you're eternal. And I am going to trust you. Even when it seems like my faith is gone, I will keep praying. I will keep pondering your goodness. I'm going to rejoice in you. And the best I know how, I'm going to put my faith in you, my hope in you, and trust you that when I can't even crawl under the fence, you give me the strength like a deer to jump over the fence and live above my circumstances. I'm telling you this morning, I feel God in this place. And I'm glad I do. And let me tell you something, friends. I believe he's pleased today. I really do. I think God's pleased. I feel like God said, that's it, son. Yes, sir. I feel like God said, that's what I wanted you to tell those people. Hey, last night I was going to preach something else. And God changed my mind. And it's like God's telling me, just encourage my people today. There's trouble sometimes. And it looks like the devil's winning. But are you listening to me? We've already won this battle, friends. We're on the winning side. Let's act like it. Let's believe God. Let's go forward for Jesus Christ. I have a question for you. I have a question for you. Don't answer this out loud. As we begin to prepare for the invitation, I've got a question for you. I don't want you to think about anybody but yourself. You've listened well today. I appreciate it. I want to ask you a question. Please don't answer this out loud. Just silently in your heart. Are you troubled? Is something going on that just is troubling you? It's agitating you. Hey, right now I think she's okay. But one of our baby girls, Joy, is having some issues. We're having tests run. Now, she's 7 years old. I get out and I pray and I beg God, oh God, touch her and heal her little body. We hope it's nothing serious. We don't think it is, but you know how it is to play on a parent's mind. It's like when I'm out walking on the road with what God taught me, going through that major depression and how he delivered me at night. It's like God just says, son, I love her. I created her. Just give her to me. You can trust me. Sometimes that's difficult, is it not? Isn't it hard sometimes to let go? I'm telling you, I want God to do something with me. I want to be a spiritual Habakkuk. I want to say, God, when I thought you had left me, you held me. God was holding me during my dark time. But he was training me to hold on to him. Today, I'm telling you, I'm not completely out of this. But the sun's shining again. May I say this to you? That's enough. God's enough, friends. Amen. By the way, if you're lost today, if you've never trusted Jesus, if you've never asked the Lord Jesus Christ to come into your heart, this rest in the day of trouble is only found in him. It's in the Lord. Today's a day of salvation. Now's the accepted time. Am I talking to somebody that if you drop dead right now, you're not sure that heaven's your home? I've got good news for you. God loves you. Jesus died for you. And if you invite him into your heart, you trust him by faith, you ask him to come into your heart, forgive your sin, and save your soul, he's promised he'll do that. And he'll give you rest. So no doubt if you need Jesus, you come. But I believe this morning the Holy Spirit of God's dealing with his children. Troublesome times, isn't it? Amen. If you're not careful, you'll become a worrywart. Scared to death. And by the way, legitimately speaking, naturally speaking, there's a reason to be afraid. But God.
Amen.
But God. You can rest.
Yeah.
In the day of trouble. I want you to bow your head with me and close your eyes for just a moment. I want to ask you a question. How many of you today say, Brother Jody, I needed this. God knows I needed this message. Would you raise your hand? You say, God knows I needed this. Yes. God bless you. In just a moment, when we open this invitation and they begin to sing whatever they're doing, I want to invite you to come. If nothing else, just to say, thank you, Lord, for speaking to my heart. I needed this today. Thank you for talking to me. Even if you can't kneel down, if you want to come have a seat on the front pew, or if you just want to make an altar there at your seat, let's turn this into a praise service. Can we do that? Is there one today, say, Brother Jody, if I drop dead of a heart attack, I'm the one you're talking about. I do not know for sure that heaven's my home. I don't know that, but I want to. See, that's a big step, you understand? If somebody doesn't even desire to know, then that's evidence that God's not dealing with them at that time at least, you understand? Or maybe they've just turned a deaf ear to the Lord, because God always deals with His Word. But if you're here today and say, I do not know for sure that I'm going to heaven, but I want to know. I desire to know. I don't know, but I want to. Is there anybody like that? Would you raise your hand? I will not come to your seat. I will not embarrass you. I will not do that. But I would like to pray for you. Let's all stand together, please. Our heads are bowed. Our eyes are closed. I'm going to pray. And I'm going to open this invitation up. And I personally believe, I'm not trying to get you to the altar. You know if you need to come. But I personally believe God wants to be praised today. I know that. We know that, right? And I believe it'd do Him honor for many of you to come that God spoke to. Get on your face if you can, on your knees, whatever, or just sit down where you are to make an altar of your seat just to say, thank you, God, for you. Thank you for you. This is the journey that Habakkuk was on. I may not can lift my voice and say thank you for what's happening, but I can lift my voice in the darkest night and say thank you for who you are. You are good. You are faithful. Father, would you take it and use it? And would you receive the praise that you so worthily deserve? In Jesus.